innovator is someone who comes up with new things or processes that are meant to deliver a benefit to its ultimate consumer. And given all the variables involved, not knowing what the consumer really wants, not knowing exactly how to change things to achieve it, an innovator ends up being largely an iterator. And so you have a starting premise, and the true successful innovators, in my experience, get very close to the customer and are knowledgeable enough with all the interactions of the pieces of a system to try to come up with true benefit. And over life, with lots of experiences, they get better and better at what I would call kind of this Darwinian evolutionary process that really goes about varying things, selecting from the variations to come up with an optimum. That's what I view as a good innovator. Joule had a unique goal, it has unique technologies, and I believe it's unique in the impact of what it can deliver. The goal we set out to achieve is to come up with a new process that could make a renewable liquid fuel that is drop-in, so we don't have to change out the engines of the world, and that is truly sustainable, so that we can actually think about it replacing all other forms of liquid fuel. And that has constraints on price, has constraints on availability, etc. So the goal in itself, one might think of it unique, one might think of it as a little crazy, but it really was a unique aspiration. The technologies that we combine to be able to achieve this are also very unique. They're unprecedented. On the one hand, we had to invent a whole new way of engineering organisms to be able to convert carbon dioxide and sunlight into a diesel fuel. That involves biological engineering, chemical engineering, process engineering, and many forms of engineering that had not been combined at that level before. We also had to come up with a whole new machine, if you will, what we call a solar converter, that, unlike solar panels that convert sunlight into electricity, now take sunlight and allow these organisms to convert into a liquid fuel, also unprecedented. And that took us to the edges of capability of materials, of mass transfer, of processing, etc. All of this within the constraints of cost and scalability. That is, how easy it would be to imagine millions of these types of devices producing the true needs at a global scale. So the technologies were unique. And finally, the impact can be unique, because we think that these combinations allow us to think about producing a diesel fuel at costs as low as $20 a barrel and with no government subsidies and price of carbon at $50 a barrel, which is quite cost competitive with the kind of oil that people are now trying to discover, the incremental barrel of oil. It is unique in its impact in that it does not compete with agricultural land at all. It is not an agricultural process, so we can use agriculture and the earth to produce the foods we need, while at the same time being able to take care of the foods our machines need, largely oil. And it also has environmental impacts. It consumes carbon just as much as it produces a liquid fuel, so that there's an effectively a carbon recycling it allows. And it's also thought to be broadly distributed when it's at the end of the day. That is, one could produce the liquid fuel closer to the point of its use. It could be made in many aspects of the world. So we don't have to think about the world as those who are oil rich and those who are oil poor and the type of conflicts that have risen from it. And it also has very significant impact. So in many regards, I think that this Joule has a very unique promise. And we're well along the way to delivering it. Well, I mean, one could imagine then if over time we had a balance between crude oil-derived liquid fuels, sugar-derived liquid fuels, and carbon dioxide-derived liquid fuels, or what we call solar fuels. That balance in the intermediate stages would certainly take away some of the monopolistic things that people do when they're controlled the only source of liquid fuels. So on the one hand, I would say that it will create price competition even before it's broadly available, in that there will be an alternative. Sugar would have to become a lot more low cost before it can effectively compete. And so that's going to drive innovation into the agriculturally derived fuel field, which is a benefit. And so in the intermediate term, I think it represents choice. In the long term, I think it promises to take away the notion of peak oil. the notion of peak oil that we've lived with for many decades, and that being that we have a finite reserve, and as that reserve is consumed, the price is expected to go up, and it from time to time does go up, and as demand increases, the price goes up. That is all a product of a naturally harvested resource, as opposed to a produced product from an infinite resource. Well, CO2, you know, we're fighting in the world to try to contain CO2 emissions. CO2 is abundantly available. Sunlight, fortunately, is abundantly available. And when those two are the raw materials, together with water that is brackish water, that is does not need to be the clean water that is suitable for agriculture, those all may break apart the elements that could create a constraint. And we think that once, over longer time periods, this notion of peak oil goes away, then people will begin to think about a more sustainable source of liquid transportation fuel. And one wonders, in the coming decades, how it might look to be able to derive our electricity from sunlight, our liquid fuels from sunlight, and how to adjust the processes in our world to adapt to this new reality. That's how it could impact the world.